Welcome to this episode of Eureka. In this episode, we have with us Professor Talat Ahmad, Vice Chancellor of Jamia, Millia, Islamia, New Delhi, and also a renowned geologist.
The 14th Vice Chancellor of Jamia, Millia, Islamia, Professor Talat Ahmad, is a renowned earth scientist. He took charge of the prestigious institute in 2014 after having served as the Vice Chancellor of the University of Kashmir. Born and brought up in a small town of Gridi in Jharkhand, Professor Ahmad is an alumnus of the Aligarh Muslim University and Jawaharlal Nehru University. He went abroad to complete his postdoctorate. In 1979, Dr. Ahmad was selected to the elite UPSC services, but soon left it to pursue his passion in geology. Professor Ahmad specialized in igneous petrology, geochemistry, and Himalayan geology before working extensively in Himalayas to understand the genesis of Precambrian magmatism. Professor Ahmad has been conferred various awards for his outstanding work. Some of the most noted among them are the National Mineral Award 1994, the JSPS Fellowship, the MHRD Fellowship for Study Abroad, and the JC Bose National Fellowship.
Thank you, sir, for coming to the show. Welcome.
Yeah.
You were born in Jharkhand.
Yes.
Even today, perhaps if we consider the nation, perhaps one of the backward kind of states, if largely one can say so. Mm. But now you are a world-renowned geologist. Can you tell us something about your childhood, where you were born, you know, what kind of atmosphere you had in your childhood?
Right. I was born in a very small town called Gridi.
Gridi?
Uh-huh. Yes. It is closer to Dhanbad.
Dhanbad, okay.
And earlier it used to be part of Bihar when I was born. And this is a coal and mica belt area. Uh-huh. And I did my schooling from Gridi in a government school known as Gridi Higher Secondary School.
Okay.
From where I did my schooling.
Mm-hmm.
And then I moved to Aligarh to do my graduation and post-graduation, then moved to JNU to do my MPhil and PhD.
So you finished your MPhil and PhD,
MPhil and PhD from Jawaharlal Nehru.
Jawaharlal Nehru University, Delhi.
Yeah.
Looking at your upbringing, for example, you did all your schooling in a government school in a remote place.
Right.
I presume most likely in what would people call as vernacular language,
you know, right.
Indian language.
It was Indian language.
But do you think it was a great hurdle for you to bloom into a scientist to,
see,
for your career?
What I have seen is that I come from, as I told you, a government school.
Mm-hmm.
But that time, very few places they used to have the big name and big schools.
Mm-hmm.
And government school itself was quite good and they were teaching us well. And lots of activities were happening in the schools. I do not know at present whether the government schools are doing the same.
Well, they are that active.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
And another advantage was that Gridi has lots of population of Bengalis.
It's, okay.
It's at the Bengal-Bihar border.
Border.
So the language that we had was mixed.
Mm-hmm.
So it was Hindi and Urdu and Bengali and everything. And at the same time, we were also taught English. So it was a good mix. And the books were again in mix. We had many of the science subjects also in Hindi.
Yeah, okay.
So when I moved from there, when I came to Aligarh, and there the medium of instruction was English,
mm-hmm.
definitely I had to do much more struggle than people who were coming from
English medium
schools.
But it was not an impossible hurdle.
No, the thing is, what I felt is that it was, see, again, the majority of the students were coming from normal schools. They were coming from small towns. So now you have to work hard to go ahead of others.
Yeah.
Okay. And most of the people who were very good in English were thinking that they know everything, but they were not. Mm-hmm. Actually, the science part, the depth of knowledge, I think that if the right sort of course is given in the school, even in government school properly, that is much stronger base. That is what is
you are kind of mentioning in your statement that a lot of activities were taking place in your school. You know, I mean, is there anything that is fresh in your memory in your young age which sort of inspired you?
Yes, yes. Even the during this puja vacation, I went to Giridi. I keep going because still my mother is there.
So, okay. So you have still roots.
I have my roots. My brother is there. So I even showed to my children, now they are not children, they are all grown up. So that this was my school. We had some very good teachers.
Okay.
And I can still, when some, always I remember is one of my teacher was Sanjay Mitra.
Sanjay Mitra.
And another was, we used to call him Panna Babu. I don't know, because Babu was something.
Yeah, very
which was very. Yeah. So we will not take the
actual
surname,
names,
but
yeah.
I will say Panna Babu. They were really good teachers, good human being, and also a friend to the students. So we were taken, you know, for all sorts of sports activities and then debate. And many such activities, which normally we should have for the development of the child.
Yeah. So that you have a holistic
approach. Another thing that was very inspiring for me, because next to my school, we had a very old house.
Okay.
Giridi has lots of people who have come, built house and gone. So one of the houses was of Sir JC Bose.
Oh.
Just...
It's greatly inspiring,
obviously.
Yes, of course.
And we were taken to show that house, and next to that house was our playground. So all the time we used to say, bhai, ye, see, we are really so much honored and lucky to have some such a great person's house at least next
very
to
Very nearby.
Our,
that's okay.
Right. Another thing that we were always also taken, because Giridi is a very beautiful place. There's a small part of the this Chota Nagpur plateau. So you have small hillocks, very beautiful rivers. There was a river, Usri River, where there was a waterfall. And when we used to go, we also used to pass many of the coal mines.
Coal mines, uh-huh.
Okay, so I was always wondering, why coal mines are here? And then during the childhood, I used to go to my mother's place, which was in Nevada. So we used to cross, and then I was told there is a place called Koderma, where there used to be lots of mica mines. So I was wondering and asking questions, even to my own parents, why we have in Giridi so much coal, and why in so how it happens and what happens. Even they were not knowing, but they were telling something. So that had kept me, you know, some sort of questions in my mind. And when
that led you to become a geologist.
That's right. And that was one of the things that I, when I was in Aligarh, I decided to have geology as one of the subjects to find out.
What is it?
What is happening. And during my studies, whenever I used to go, whatever we were taught, and practically I used to go and try to verify these in the field when I used to go home. Okay, in addition to what normal field work which was done in the Himalayas, in Rajasthan and other parts.
You also used to go back to your own place.
I used to go back to my own and try to answer my questions which I had during the childhood. And it was very convincing.
If you were to name some two or three people from your childhood who inspired you, who would you put them?
See, one of the person who was really inspiring was one of my own teacher, as I said, Sanjay Mitraji. Mm-hmm. He was a very good teacher, very smart person, a good sportsman also.
Okay.
So he used to play and then...
Very colorful we personality.
Very, very nice and sing. Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. So very inspiring person and very knowledgeable in the sense when we were small, he used to talk big things. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So we used to admire how much knowledge he has. Mm-hmm.
So he was able to open up your vision.
Right.
Yeah, maybe we need to take a small break here. Okay. We'll come back after a break. We are having a very interesting conversation. We'll have a small break. Don't go away. We'll come back to you again. Welcome back to this episode of Eureka. We are having a very exciting conversation with Professor Talat Ahmad. Thank you, sir. We were talking before the break about three personalities who inspired you. One you said was Sanjay Mitra, who was your teacher.
Yeah.
Please go ahead.
Another person who was really a big inspiration for me was my own uncle.
Oh.
Mm. And he used to be a doctor.
Okay.
And he was a doctor and at the same time he was also a naturalist.
Uh-huh,
in the sense that he used to take us around, show us birds, because somehow the area was very full of, you know, it's a hot spot sort of thing.
Rich of biodiversity,
biodiversity,
birds
trees. And the third person is one of my own teachers from Aligarh when I was a student. And I was fortunate, he was a very good teacher in the sense that again, I really tried to mimic when I was teaching in Delhi. So he was very young, energetic person, and he was specialized in structural geology. And he used to, without waiting for any attendant to come, he used to take the fold rag things and run with the samples, you know,
to show.
And then in the field also, he was very meticulous. We learned lots of things.
All the three examples that you spoke of were passionate people. You know,
very,
I mean, very, very passionate.
That's right.
It's very interesting and we are very happy.
Yeah.
Let's move to a different question, which I am sort of very curious. See, today, if you look at the world map, the India is along with Asia.
Right.
It's a touching Asia. Yeah? So, India and Asia are connected by land with, of course, Himalayas in between. But quite long ago, there was no Himalaya and India was not in this place in the globe where it is today. And you studied, I'm told,
rocks.
About the India when it was very, very far away from where it was today.
Right.
Can you sort of explain to us what it is, where was it, how far back it was?
See, I have done lots of studies on the volcanic rocks, the volcanoes. Okay. And we know... in the past, I studied rocks which were about 2.5 billion years old.
2.5 billion, meaning about 25 crore.
Okay. So, my PhD work I did in Rajasthan, there's a place called Nathdwara, where we have very famous Aravalli volcanics. And then when I was working as scientist at Wadi Institute.
And Aravallis are said to be one of the oldest
one
mountains.
One of the oldest mountain chain of the earth,
world.
On the earth. And it has been eroded, but still Aravalli Ridge is there, which reaches Delhi still. And then I worked on similar rocks in the Himalayas.
Okay.
In Garhwal, Kumaon, Himachal. And tried to understand that, see, that time, as you said, there was no Himalayas. Okay. So what it used to be, there used to be lots of volcanoes, island arcs, and the temperature of the earth was much hotter than what it is today, because earth has been losing temp. And that time, there were lots of volcanism, much, much more than what we have now.
We have today. That time means about 25 crore years ago.
25 crores. Okay. So, these volcanic activity used to bring lots of things from the mantle, the deeper part
from
of the mantle.
Outside, right?
And it used to come on the surface and then get distributed. And then that was also reasons that during this period, you had lots of mineralization.
Okay.
Uh-huh. Because lots of things came. So if you see world over, all the big mineral deposits come during that period.
About 25,000 crore ago, when there was volcanoes which brought things from under the earth
from the depth, distributed it on the surface, and then it got recycled and then got deposited. So there were island arcs, what we have now like Hawaii or Andes and other places where we have magmatic activity. And that time India was a neighbor of South Africa and Australia and
Antarctica. So we were that southern part of the globe, and we have now moved towards
that. And then there were lots of breaking and making up of continents. It used to be called as supercontinents.
Pangaea.
The Pangaea and then the Gondwana land. Mm-hmm. So many times they came together and broke. Why they broke was because when you conceal part of the surface of the earth, the heat which is generated, because that was, so it will break. It's called plume activity.
Plume
so
activity.
It comes, heats the whole area. Like if you are making cake, you heat. So there will be sort of an expansion, development of cracks. And then you push it further, it goes away.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So then it have this circulation.
So basically what you are saying is that there were huge continents and then the plume sort of broke it up into pieces.
And then it moved and then again came back, and the new oceans were created. Then these things go and then again they join, they become two, Laurentia and Pangaea and all these activities.
Mm-hmm.
So my interest was to understand that these volcanic activities, what was the chemistry of the rock, because I am a geochemist, and try to see what are the possibilities of mineral deposits and how that can be. Because I am a firm believer of having some sort of conceptual way of looking at mineral deposits.
Okay.
It's not, what has happened is in India, we have lots of mineral deposits, but most of them were old finds, like people say,
accidentally you just
right. You know, we find old workings and then you try to find deposits.
Mm-hmm.
But now we have come to a stage and we should try to evolve this system to model things and try to look for, you know, that
most
this
rock, probable
yeah,
place where
this area or this region and this rock type should have this type of deposits, rather than chance discovery. Okay, that is what should be the science of the country
of
in
the
future,
country, yeah.
Particularly the earth sciences.
Very interesting point that you made. Maybe we need to take a small break and then we'll come back and discuss some of these issues. We'll take a small break. Don't go back. We'll come back again. Welcome back to this episode of Eureka. We are with us a renowned geologist, Professor Talat Ahmad from Jamia, Millia, Islamia. He is a Vice Chancellor over there and he has done extensive study on what is called as Precambrian geology. Thank you, sir. I mean, I want to ask you one question. I was told that you met our Prime Minister and spoke about the need for bringing in geology to schools. Can you elaborate?
Yes, I had the fortunate moment for me to see the Prime Minister, and he had called scientists from different areas, mm-hmm. and I was representing our sciences.
Mm-hmm.
So I stressed upon this that we should have teaching of earth sciences in school, so that the children should, it should not be a strange subject when they come to university or colleges. And invariably it happens that people are aware of physics, chemistry, maths, biology, not geology or geography. And this is the Mother Earth, and for understanding the Mother Earth, you have to have these subjects also being taught. And definitely, like I was interested, although we were given only a small portion of geography, we should make it more attractive at the school level to make them to understand the importance, because now with this climate change and pollution and many other things, if we have bright children also getting into earth science and environment, okay, things will be much better.
So what you are essentially pointing out is with the changing times, that as we are entering into the 21st century,
that's right,
where the climate change is one of the biggest challenge for humanity,
issues, yes,
we need bright young people researching, questioning, examining, sure, on climate change issues,
right,
how it got formed, which means geology,
and how
where the resources are.
Right.
You know, I mean, so these are all issues you say are important, and then we should retune our school systems
school
to meet
system
this challenge.
And school system, and also the syllabi. See, in the universities, we should try to have more applicable, you know, applied things. We should do fundamental research, but at the same time, ultimately, the spin-off should be to help us for the society. We will do science ultimately. Why we are doing science?
Right.
Okay. So, for example, now we know that climate change is happening. Everybody is talking, and our children who are going to be say 25 years from now, we have to know much more than what we bothered about the glaciers, for example, in
okay.
the Himalayas.
Okay.
Okay, because that is going to be water is going to be the main things, you know, if in future in terms of resources.
Resources.
Okay, which is getting
one of the scarce resources
scarce.
For future is
That's
going
right.
to be water. Yeah.
So what is
it's
the
not
strategy?
Gold.
It is not gold. It is the water. Because we can stay without gold.
Yeah.
I can survive whole life without wearing a gold. But I cannot survive if I don't take water even for one day.
One day.
All right? So, our aim should be that the youngsters should not only think about physics, chemistry, maths, biology, but also geology. Because they have to be mixed.
Mixed.
Because it should not be that geology you can do alone and solve
Without
problems.
So,
for example, we did study the Kedarnath disaster.
Yeah,
I made a report in which we also, and then now in Jamia Millia, we have started a course on disaster management. In which
so you mean to say that even issues like, for example, disaster management,
yeah,
there is a connection between geography
it
and
has to be. It
geology.
It is
yes,
geology,
so
geography, environment.
Yeah.
Now, but I am not stopping at just these three, but this disaster management. I am also involving engineering students, social work.
So, in some
students,
sense, we also need to look at a kind of a multidisciplinary
approach has to
I
be
I want
there.
To ask you one question. You know, I mean, you have had a very long, interesting career. You joined Delhi University as a teacher. Then you went to Wadia Research Institute as a researcher. Then you went to Kashmir as a Vice Chancellor.
That's right.
And then now again you are back in Delhi, in Jamia Millia Islamia as a
right.
Vice Chancellor. You seem to be sort of moving around.
See, the thing is, one should not feel that is the ultimate you have reached.
Yeah.
You have to always think.
Keep moving.
And keep moving, try to find, explore new areas. When I was offered Kashmir University Vice Chancellorship, you know, when I was teaching in Delhi University, I had two thoughts, because there were people were also scaring that, you know, Kashmir is disturbed. But I, as a geologist, I all thought that this will be right time, at least all the weekends I will use
for doing the studies.
And I did.
Good.
Okay? And I brought also the Earth Science Department in Kashmir University. Now it's very visible. Lots of people I got from outside and within Kashmir made this. Another campus I opened in Leh, and Kargil. So that, see, I have spent about 20 years, every year I used to go to Ladakh to do my
work. Your research work.
And all the time, and I have seen how things have grown in. It was a very, very remote area. We used to camp. Now,
it's in the international
grown.
Tourist map,
that's
actually.
Right.
Yeah, that's true.
And then always I was feeling that this area needs to be given education. There are schools.
Yeah.
And then children used to go to either Delhi or Jammu or Kashmir.
Future, I mean,
or
like
anywhere.
Higher education, that's
right.
What.
So, for development of any area.
I want to ask you here an interesting question. I mean, you have been a vice chancellor of two universities, and then you have been a teacher for quite long in a very important university in the country, Delhi University. What do you think is our major challenge for higher education?
The higher education, we need to make it more practical. Okay, it should not be just theory that you give theory. All the students should be given some way of researching.
Okay.
At every stage.
So what you are pointing out is that our higher education needs to be have connection with research right research. From the undergraduate. So it's not a research only in your PhD, but you have a flavor of research right from your...
No, because I tell you, many places, like I was a postdoc in Cambridge, there is nothing like master's. They do BSc and then they do PhD.
PhD sometimes.
Okay,
yes,
so the true. BSc itself,
you have a research.
They have research component, 1 year full. All right.
So this is an interesting point, and unfortunately we are running out of time.
Okay.
But this is an important message, I think, for all the educationists to deeply think about, which is that why not our higher education, right from undergraduate level, give a flavor of research to our students so that our students become thinking human being, you know, with thinking cap.
Right.
And it's a very important message from you, sir, as a vice chancellor and also a educationist and also a world-renowned geologist. Thank you for your this opportunity to be in this show. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much.